Well, good morning. Welcome to Industry Day for the Joint Enterprise Defense Infrastructure Cloud, or JEDI, program. We're very excited about the strong presence here today, given competition and innovation are at the heart of leveraging the private sector. The greater the pool of resources, the greater our confidence that we have maximized the value to our department and to our warfighter. Over the past months, there's been a tremendous amount of information and speculation shared about the efforts of the department to move to the cloud. We welcome the chance today to inform everyone about the details of what this program is and how it will be executed. We need to be very clear. This program is truly about increasing the lethality of our department and providing the best resources to our men and women in uniform. JEDI Cloud is just one contract and part of a much larger strategy for overall IT efforts. Looking forward, the department is not anticipating funding above the out-year levels in the fiscal 19 budget, and in order to fund incremental resources the military needs to achieve its mission requirements, we must lower our cost of operations to yield these resources. The global challenges to our military remain significant, and to best equip our military to meet the mission, we must consider significant reforms in the department. Real quick, just a show of hands, how many might have read the unclassified version of the National Defense Strategy? It's great. It's very helpful, and those that haven't, we highly recommend it. I think it gives you a great perspective of where we're going. IT is just one of the lines of effort we are working in the area of shared or common services, and our goal is to increase operational efficiencies and decrease financial costs. In the IT world, we are focusing on process, people, and technology, with efficiency products in many areas to include infrastructure, network operations, enterprise services, hosting and cloud, applications, and organizational policies and procedures. Not only do many IT projects generate financial savings, but they also provide warfighters access to important capabilities and data they don't currently have. This and other operational improvements increase lethality and readiness. Leveraging the commercial cloud is one IT area that we believe will achieve operational, financial, and security benefits, of which the JEDI Cloud contract is a great example. We believe this program takes a significant step in fully leveraging commercial products and services to quickly and economically meet our operational needs. We are well aware we need to better utilize the private sector and its tremendous innovation, competition, and resources, and this program represents our continued movement in this direction. However, we ask for your participation in this program. We need to work together to truly optimize the mutual benefits and achieve the optimal outcome. Today, our goal is to inform you of all aspects of this program. Brigadier General Crum from the Joint Staff will explain why this matters to the warfighter. Ellen Lord will discuss the acquisition strategy. Our acting CIO, S.E. Miller, will give you a good overview of how this fits into the department's modernization plans. And you'll also hear from the Defense Digital Service and the Strategic Capabilities Office with their perspectives on how this effort fits into leveraging commercial innovations. Lastly, we get detailed information on this specific solicitation and how it'll work. Please follow each of these discussions closely. Take into account that each of these perspectives is how we assembled the strategy on this program. By incorporating our intent into your responses, you will help us achieve the optimal outcome we are seeking. As we pursue this program, it is essential we execute in an open manner. This competition for the JEDI Cloud will be transparent and a full and open competition. We're committed to this process. We welcome you to this Industry Day and thank you for being part of this process, which ultimately benefits our men and women in uniform in executing their mission. We hope it's a great day. and we thank you for being here.
Good morning, everybody. Distinguished visitors, ladies and gentlemen, Chris Lynch. Thank you for coming out on this rainy day. My name is David Crum, and I work for Lieutenant General Roddy in the J-8, and I'm the DoD guy for requirements. And what I'm going to try to do today is enlighten you to something you may not have known before, and that we're not talking to you about an IT contract today. Now, realize I welcomed you all as ladies and gentlemen, and that was not my original opening line. My original opening line was, it's good to be with all the nerds and geeks from the software and computer industry. I was explicitly told I shouldn't use that line because it might be offensive. And I said it's a badge of honor because we need you guys, and we need you guys to be a part of that. So I'm here today to talk to you about the journey that we're on, and this journey we're going to take together. Well, actually, not with most of you. But for some of you, it's going to be awesome. So what I'm going to explain today, and oh, by the way, you don't really have a choice because I have the microphone, is we're going to talk about what the requirements mean. If you'll indulge me, well, I'll talk about what we mean when we talk about cloud computing. I'll approach it from the over senior leader viewpoints that I've gathered, but then I'm going to give you a little bit different perspective, and I hope you'll hang with me for this. First off, I need you guys to know that this isn't an effort just by DDS. This is an effort for the entire Department of Defense. The Joint Requirements Oversight Council, or the JROC as we call it, because you know everything has to have an acronym. That's chaired by the Vice Chairman of the Joint Chief of Staff, that's General Paul Selva. The other voting members are the Vice Chief of Staff of each of the services, along with representation from across the DoD. So as you probably can tell, it's got great influence. And that group, with DDS as the catalyst, has defined the requirements for this project. Let there be no doubt, these requirements are demanding, they're tough, and they're actually what we need to kickstart DoD into using cloud computing. And I know that the detail of these requirements will be shared with all of you a little bit later, but let me give you that senior level viewpoint and then into the warfighters. That lens that we're going to talk about, the warfighters lens, that's something that I want you to take from today. Because when you only think about IT, you don't think about killing people and breaking things. This is not an IT project. We know that we in DoD must adapt to a cloud infrastructure and a platform service so we can create a global, resilient, secure environment that enables warfighting across the globe. That includes mission command at the very tactical level up to the highest levels of government. That means we need greater lethality, agility, and improved decision-making from the soldier that's fighting hand-to-hand combat to the four-star making decisions with real-time data. The requirements mean that we're going to need to have resiliency. And for us, cloud resiliency means availability with no single points of failure across a very diverse geographical landscape in austere or connectivity challenged, because that's a politically correct term, areas, and it depends, and it's all over the globe. We need the cyber defenses to be robust, and they need actually to augment what we already do and innovate with us, the DoD cyber forces. We have multiple cyber malicious activities ongoing with us every single day, and it will only increase with this initiative. We need you to make sure that your project allows our DoD cyber warriors to have access tools and system permissions to counter those cyber threats. We also need you to be able to train us. The path that we have today, if you look behind me, is littered with the corpses of dead programs that failed to deliver. One of the reasons is we did not understand how to use the technology provided. I need you to train the users and the operators so they can use the system and not just your people. There are other top-level requirements that you're going to get But that's just kind of a broad overview. And I need to emphasize to you that this effort is going to continue. General Selva, through the JROC chair, has directed DDS to come back and give regular updates to the JROC on the status and the progress of this project. And when we do that, he and the other senior leaders are going to look for other ways to integrate more data and more sources, more programs, so that we can scale this for as much of the Department of Defense as we can. I know what you're thinking. Well, that sounds just like an IT project. It's not. In fact, if you're just here to bid on an IT project to bring your commercial business system, this is just another government project with low margins and a lot of frustration. You couldn't be more wrong. Ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be more than an IT system. This is not email. This is not file storage. This is not data transfer. This is about how us and you, together, we're going to change the way that this nation, its soldiers, its sailors, its Marines, and its airmen fight and win our nation's wars. I'm going to digress a little bit. I'm going to tell you a story that happened about 20 years ago. In 1999, I was flying over southern Iraq in support of the UN resolution of the no-fly zones. On this day, I took off with about 50 other airplanes, and we started north. And we crossed into southern Iraq on our way to make sure that Saddam Hussein's airplanes didn't fly and bomb and kill his own people. As we made our way north, I was in an F-15C fighter. And when you cross the southern middle part of Iraq and you look down, you don't see anything. It might be one of the most barren landscapes in the world looking down from the air. No one lives there. There's no roads. There's no nothing. And it was really just kind of geographical territory that we had to cross to get up north and to get just south of Baghdad so that we could make sure that his enemy aircraft stayed on the ground and, again, didn't hurt or injure his own people. So it was kind of the boring part of the mission. And as we made our way up, I was flying about 40,000 feet. I had my wingman about 2 miles away from me, and we started up. All 50 aircraft are crossing into southern Iraq. And I'm looking at the map because in this day I'm the mission commander, so I'm orchestrating this entire mess. And as I look down, I'm looking at the map, making sure we're going where we need to go. Now, everyone tells me I didn't do this. I heard something. So I looked up, and I looked over at my wingman. And I saw this little black cloud. And I was puzzled. I didn't understand what it was. And then I saw another one. And then I saw another one. And all of a sudden, the air all around me was filled with flak, with anti-aircraft fire. I called for evasive maneuvers. We got out of there able to survive without injury or actually even without damage to the aircraft. We actually continued the mission. But no one knew what to think initially. Matter of fact, I was actually accused of making it up at first because there was nothing there. And some of my leadership went, "Did you really see something?" It wasn't until a little bit later that we put the pieces together. Saddam Hussein had clandestinely sent down an entire battalion, we think, of over 100-millimeter AAA anti-aircraft artillery. And he had done it because he had seen us cross day after day in the southern part of Iraq with no evasive maneuvers, no nothing. And he thought, that's where I'm going to shoot down an airplane. And if it wasn't by the grace of God and their poor aim, Captain David Crum wouldn't be here today, quite frankly. Why did I tell you that story from 20 years ago? Because when I landed, and a few hours later, I found out that someone actually did know about that. That they actually knew that that had transpired before I took off. That information was available. It was on a system that didn't talk to anything else. It was on an information system that was isolated from other information systems. And it was not only not accessible by the people who needed it, i.e. me, it had to be manually transcribed, phone called, and sent over. Because when they built that system, they built a great one for itself. They didn't build it for the enterprise. And they didn't share it. That was 1999. Actually, subtract a 9. 1999. Almost 20 years ago. I do not know how many times a similar situation where the information that was needed by our warfighters didn't get to them, and decisions were made that were wrong, and how many times the outcomes weren't quite as favorable. Today, we're here to change that. For basically a quarter of a century, the DoD has had same system where we've isolated our data. We've made it secure. We've protected it. It's incompatible. We didn't know anyone else could use it. Or we didn't have enough money to expand it. Or we were going to have manual workarounds. That day ends with you guys. And if you're a student of military history, you know that lives have been saved and lost, and that battles and wars have been won or lost based upon either bad, no, or late information. This is what DoD knows now. It's something that all of you guys take for granted. It's kind of your bedrock when it comes to data, that the movement, the access, and the use of data in near instantaneous ways is a commonplace. It's not for us. It will be. And that's the only way we know that in the future that our warfighters across the globe are going to win. We need to take your commercial solutions, and we need to integrate them into the military. We need to put them on a global scale in both an unclassified and classified environment. That information has to be available to the warfare on the tactical edge, not just the headquarters. It's got to be available anywhere, anytime. Everyone in this room knows that our nation has enjoyed military dominance for quite a long time. If we don't solve this, we won't keep that level of overmatch. Ladies and gentlemen, the information has to be available to an F-35 that's entering a hostile area where a new surface-to-air missile pops up. It has to be available to a submarine that's submerged to get new mission orders. It has to be available to an Army platoon that a friendly unit is just around the block and does not open fire. It's got to be available to a platoon of Marines that are about to breach a door that an IED has been found. It's got to be made available to our special forces that there's an ambush plot. The information has to be made available. Whichever one of you wins this, I'm challenging you to bring your A game. This is not an IT project. This is going to make a difference, like few things have, to get data to our warfighters when and where he or she needs it. It is not an IT contract. Is about ensuring that the women and men who fight our nation's war win, period. And if you're not prepared for that, you don't need to be here. That's what this is about. I need you all to understand that we're going to ask you to build a global fabric that encompasses both DoD military and civilians, and let there be no doubt that we will use this technology to make us more efficient, and we're going to make it more effective. And when we say effective, we mean more lethal. That means more bad guys meet their maker. That means more innocents are discriminated against the enemy, and they don't. It means we'll have the information we need exactly when we need it, and this is a critical part of where we're going, and you get to be a part of it. It's not an IT system. It is enabling the warfighter and fulfilling their requirements. But not only about being lethal, it's about coming home. Some of you may not know it, but you're close to hallowed ground. Just over your shoulders is Arlington Cemetery. I know it's wet, and I know it's rainy. I encourage you to spend some time after the conference today to go walk the hills. Go between those rows of tombstones And in particular, I want you to pay attention to the dates on those two stones, the start and the end. Sometimes when you track those years together, you get a number that's really low. If we do this right, if we do this together, you and your team will be responsible for making some of those end dates not as close. You'll be responsible for making a few fewer tombstones up there because more of our sons, our daughters, our moms and dads, aunts and uncles, friends, they come home. They come home because the information was available to them when they needed it, and we were able to make the right decision to bring them home. I'm not asking you to build an IT system. I'm asking you to help us redefine how we defend our nation, how we win our nation's wars, and bring our men and women home. I look forward to working with you, and I want you to bring it. Thank you very much.
My world, 3.4 million users, approximately 4 million endpoint devices, over 1,700 data centers, and approximately 500 different cloud initiatives across the department today. This is not about modernization. It's about hardening the surface that gives folks like Dave Crum the opportunity and the environment to successfully execute their mission. But to me, it means I live in a complex and a diverse world that I have an opportunity to do four things: to standardize, to simplify, and to secure so that our warfighters and our business operators can share. But in doing that, we can't lose sight that the protection of the data and the mission assurance are paramount to the safety of our warfighters. The technological advances that you bring to the table from the commercial environment make it compelling for me and the department to relook how we're doing security. So I want to spend just a couple minutes answering those compelling questions if I were sitting with you, you would ask. Number one, we just sat in an industry day on MilCloud 2.0 a few weeks ago at DISA. How does that differ from what we're doing with JEDI? I would tell you, we're thinking about this holistically, and the two are very complementary, and one not to be discounted for the other as you look at and review the RFP. This is about understanding what information and capability are critical enough that we have to keep it on-prem because we need it closest, and what are those functional areas and opportunities that are ripe for transitioning to a commercial environment, and how do we do that in a way, again, that it's still protected. So don't lose sight as you look at this that there's a competition between the two. JEDI and MilCloud 2.0 are intended to be complementary. Second question, but you got that dang cloud security requirements guide out there. We're up to version 3.0, and it's very prescriptive in how we do business. It was intended to be prescriptive when we started this, but it will continue to evolve such that we can maximize the opportunities while operating at an acceptable level of risk. But you guys have an opportunity to tell us what are the new ways of doing this and what opportunities are ahead of us from a security aspect. It's no longer, I won't say no longer, Roger will kill me. It is less about protecting the boundary of the network and the physical limitations, It's more about protecting the data and exposing it to the individuals and functions who need it in a real-time basis. This is about capturing best practices that you guys bring that can help us. Third question, risk management framework. Many of you that were at the AFSEA event last week heard me say, okay, Chris, I got you, I hear you. He told me my comment should be just blow it away. Don't quote me on that one. Little less, we're going to turn it on its side is a better way I like to say it. I get it, over 600 controls. I get it, a cumbersome process. I get it that it is very compliance and artifact based. We have an opportunity to reshape how we're doing this, to make it more agile, more responsive, and then determine how best this applies to a commercial environment or enhance our opportunities to take advantage of commercial capabilities. Cloud computing enables the department to consolidate infrastructure, leverage IT commodity functions, eliminate functional redundancies while improving continuity of operations. Many of you have shareholders that you have to please, and getting or winning this opportunity, I think, would be a great one to do that. But I don't want you to lose sight of the reason we're doing it. This is about increased effectiveness and capability, but most importantly, to me, this is about life and limb. So if you listen closely to what Dave Crum is saying, it's, I have a responsibility to make sure as you are bringing capabilities, commercial capabilities for us to maximize, that I can still operate in a secure environment, that I have the flexibility and the agility to enable warfighting operations. So I ask that as you look at the opportunity in front of you, don't shrug the security piece, but help me to find a balance between operational effectiveness, efficiency, and risk. Thank you.
So I have to admit, I'm a little bit embarrassed. I was told everybody would be in t-shirts, so. I guess that General Crum was playing a joke on me on that. So hi, I'm Chris. I guess what you could call, I'm a nerd. I head up a team called Defense Digital Service. We're based out of the Pentagon. This is one of yet a long list of extremely strange and unusual experiences in my life that I never thought I'd be part of. If you don't know much about my team, let me just tell you what we do. So I have the sometimes difficult task of going out to our nation and finding the best software engineers, the best product designers, the best product managers and bureaucracy hackers, and convincing them to come into the Department of Defense to work on problems where technology fails the mission of national defense. I like to say that it's a little bit like a tour of duty for nerds. So actually, I think the term nerd is actually okay, just so everybody knows. And when people come, the problems are sometimes heartbreaking. You know, I like to say that many times, this is one of the most difficult things for people on my team to actually participate in. We come and we see some of the worst projects, some of the biggest challenges. But occasionally, we get to take our skill set, something that we take for granted in the world that we come from outside of federal government, and we get to pair it with the people who own the mission. And I gotta tell you, those are the things that actually will live with me long after I leave this job, long after I leave this area. And it's interesting standing here today to talk about the Joint Enterprise Defense Infrastructure, or JEDI. And the reason it's interesting is because, you know, I started DDS just over 2 years ago. And at the time, we made a list. And we were like, what would it be like? What would success look like for DDS? What could I walk away from and be like, we made a difference? What would that be? One of the things was, hey, what if we were to kind of take the model of how we think about security and test security? What if we were to turn that around? Come up with a new approach. And we ended up launching a program called Hack the Pentagon, which at the time was the first ever federal bug bounty program. We brought in 1,400 hackers. Coincidentally, nobody in the building wanted to do that. And we set them loose on defense.gov. And that program has become so successful now, it's spread throughout the entire department. But one of the things that was on that list, literally day one, one of the things that we had on that list was commercial cloud. So you can imagine how precious this moment is, looking at all of you talking about JEDI. Because at the time, we didn't know how we would do it. And to be honest, we didn't even have an office, so like that was another problem. So we had a bunch of things that we had to figure out, right? So we said, okay, we don't have all the things that we need in order to pull this off just yet. So let's just put it on the back burner, but we'll come back to it. And we do what we do. We find a place where there's a problem, we go to where the work is, and we work on problems of impact. And we said, eventually, we'll have enough proof points, we'll have enough background, we'll have enough things that we've worked on to make the case, the commercial cloud, something that we take for granted in the world that I come from, have the case to say that this is what we need at the Department of Defense. And I mentioned this before, but there's a mantra within my team, which is go to where the work is. And I think that that's important. Because what that actually means is that, well, it's great, we have our offices in the Pentagon, we have an office now. We get to go around and we get to see some of the most incredible problems. Some of them are very heartbreaking, but we get to travel to some interesting places. Some of them are fantastic places, unlike anything else. And sometimes we go to austere places, and then sometimes we go to places where the mission is life or death. I like to send our team to the places where people like us don't generally get to show up and work on things that matter. And I thought that I would tell you a few stories about some of the things that I have seen over my 2 years here since starting Defense Digital Service that have led to this moment. Nearly every place that we go, I hear a very similar thing. I meet some of the bravest, most talented men and women in uniform and out of uniform who say, I just want to do it better, the thing that I'm working on. Whether it's analyzing the data to better understand where our adversaries are, whether it's automating some of the work that they are currently focused on to better protect us and them. I hear it all the time. But when you go out to these places, you go out to these austere environments, one of the things that you see is that they don't have access to the basic tools that they need to do the things that I take for granted every place else but here. And we make excuses for it. We say, well, it's the DoD, it's the federal government. That's not okay. It's not okay. And the reason that I bring that up is I'm going to go back to something that General Crum said. He said it's not about an IT system, and that's true. I'll say it's not even about the technology. Something much bigger than that. This is about the ability to do the mission of national defense. To find the barriers where technology fails that mission and do it more effectively, to do it with more lethality, to be relevant in that mission. It's interesting. You know, I have a couple things that we've seen. We went to one place recently, and In the middle of an operation, live real-time feeds were coming in, guiding operators to keep them out of harm's way. And the data center providing that feed flooded. No failover, nothing. Literally, people are running around trying to figure out, how do we keep the servers above water just long enough to finish up this thing that's happening? That's crazy. That's a true story. That should make you angry, because it makes me angry, right? I had somebody at another place tell me, on a system that's really important, they were talking about the failover that they had for that system. And they said, 15 minutes, that's our service level. 15 minutes. I'm thinking seconds, right? Think about that. These are mission-critical systems. We have not kept pace with the things that I and many of you take for granted outside of the constraints of the federal government. And it's not okay. And it's interesting, when you look at all the things that are happening, much of this is about changing the foundational layers of what it means to build the systems that support the mission of national defense. What do I mean by that? Well, we have infrastructure. A lot of times when we talk at the Department of Defense, we talk about data centers, right? We think about it like, hey, we got servers that are in Iraq, we've got virtualization, we've got storage and all these things, and those are great foundational layers. Those are definitely incredibly important. But where the world has evolved around these platform services, all these things that sit above those, that use those foundational layers to remove us from the burden of having to do the things that we used to have to do, right? Instead of buying database licenses, many of the platform services have database services that they offer on top of them, right? That you can just take advantage of. Just removes the thinking, right? We gain so much by taking advantage of these things, and it's amazing. It's interesting. I have a team right now basically looking at a system that is absolutely struggling. Actually, somebody just came in, Casey over there, just came back from a trip to look at a system. Antiquated. A database hadn't been updated for a very long time. Can't keep up with the load of where it sits. And it goes down, and it's a really important system. We have to do better. We have to do better. And so, you know, I think to myself, what if we were to take advantage of all these incredible solutions that have been developed and driven by people who have nothing to do with the federal government, right? What if we were to unlock those capabilities to do the mission of national defense? What if we were to take advantage of the long tail marketplaces that have developed in the commercial cloud industry? That's what JEDI is. That's why it's so important. Because we get to take advantage of the innovation that has not yet come to us. We get to take advantage of the innovation that we aspire to use. We get to take advantage of things, in some cases, things that have become commonplace in the commercial software industry, but have not yet become commonplace within how we do our own mission. And I'm not just talking about infrastructure, and I'm definitely not just talking about technology here. I want to hit that point again. While we're looking at things like servers and compute and storage and the networking layers and all those things that sit underneath all that, those are great foundational pieces, and absolutely JEDI must offer those. But really what I'm talking about is a better way for us to do that mission, right? A better way to analyze the data that is available to us. You heard the general talk about sharing information. I hear that one all the time. How do I do something just as simple as taking this incredible data set that I have and making it available for others to actually analyze, assess, and better understand the mission and where our adversaries are, what they're doing, how we better protect the people who are in these incredibly difficult environments? They don't have an answer that's very easy today. I hear it all the time. And it breaks my heart. How we share, how we process, how we exchange and internalize information is really what JEDI is intended to drive. And when you look at it and you look at all these things, it is the basis of how the Department of Defense works. We must see this, we must trust the information that we're receiving. We must be able to convey a command and ensure that it's going to go out to the warfighter and trust that that whole thing is going to be executed flawlessly. And we see JEDI as being an instrumental piece to that. And when I think about it, I think of the immediacy of the need. You know, it's interesting. You know, I go back to all these different environments that we go to, and, you know, think about what the options are that are available to people today. Let's say that you're out in an austere environment, and you say, you know what, I want to automate some of this workload. I want to just change a couple things about it. I want to come up with a better way to analyze and assess some of the feeds that we have coming in about our mission. What's the option available to them? Order a new server? Buy the software licenses to install in that? Get an ATO? How long does that take? At least a week, right? Yeah, right. It's really heartbreaking when you think that the average deployment in some places is 6 months. Think about that. Yeah. So what happens? You don't get to do the thing. You're long gone by the time any of that stuff is available to you. I keep saying the word heartbreaking because it is, because it's important, because it matters. Because it's a thing that has impact, and it's a thing that we all care about. The immediacy is important. We cannot wait 6 months. We cannot wait a year. JEDI is about providing those resources to the warfighter quickly, easily, and at a speed that they today don't have available to them. And lastly, when I think about the solutions, I think about things like modern best practices. You know, my team, we spend a lot of time going into places and bringing in things like DevOps and all these concepts that we think about, you know, automating various parts of how we build systems and deploy systems and making sure that things are done the same way every single time. This is a foundational layer. JEDI is a foundational layer. It helps us become better at building things that are repeatable. It helps us become better at building things that are reliable, scalable, and secure. And I know because we run Hack the Pentagon. So, you know, I want to leave to you three things that when you're thinking about what it means to be part of JEDI, what are the three things that we must hit? What are three things that we must provide in this solution? One, you know, if it wasn't our team that was leading the acquisition, some other alternate universe, I would say, take your commercial cloud solution and bend it around the Department of Defense. I'm here to tell you that's not what we want. We want to bend the Department of Defense around the commercial cloud. I can't make that point enough. We want it here, and we want it out in those austere environments. We want to bring this to the warfighter. It must go out to them as well. We have failed if we do not do that. The other one is that it must offer the foundational blocks, because those are the things that are going to give us the ability to experiment with new things that we have yet to anticipate infrastructure as a service, right? Compute, storage, networking, the basics. Gives us the ability to play. That's the second thing. The third is platform as a service. It must be more than a data center. It must be more than a data center. Better monitoring, identity, failover, scalability, possibly even artificial intelligence and machine learning. And we want to make sure that as the commercial sector for software and the great innovation that's happening there continues to evolve, that we're able to take advantage of it. There's so much that we can gain by having that. So those are the three things. Commercial cloud, and we really mean it, commercial cloud. Infrastructure as a service, platform as a service. Those three things. And I'm looking for you to help us arrive at that place. That's what success is. That's how we will know that JEDI has worked. Is when the story that General Crum told is not the norm. When I go out to some of the most hostile places around the world, the people tell us, I saw a problem, and we spun up a bunch of new stuff on top of JEDI, and we solved that problem. And maybe we saved a life. Maybe we made an impact. That's success. I look forward to all of you taking us there. And I promise that the next industry day for JEDI, everybody will wear t-shirts.
We're reorganizing, and as of February 1, I am the Undersecretary of Acquisition and Sustainment. We know that we need to change and modernize, but it's very important to be specific about why we are changing and what we're trying to achieve. The organization that I led until a couple of weeks ago, AT&L, was created by the Goldwater-Nichols Act of 1986. So let's think a little bit about what's different between 1986 and today. The technology landscape has changed. It's changed significantly. We have a proliferation of technology that empowers, and it's really a democratization of technology. It's had a profound effect on the world and on our national security. The business landscape has changed. The DoD is no longer the driver of all technologies. We no longer have all the experts in the technologies that we're working with. Commercial industry, startups, and global corporations now deliver cutting-edge technologies. And the threat has changed. The National Defense Strategy, which guides all that we do in the Pentagon, identifies strategic competition with sophisticated nation states, deterring rogue regimes, defeating terrorism, and consolidating gains in Iraq and Afghanistan as concurrent objectives. We as a nation have the ability to address these objectives and benefit from these trends, but not with an acquisition system or business models from 1986. We must embrace change. It's been just over a month since we've stood up the Acquisition and Sustainment Organization, and we're really viewing this as a rare opportunity, frankly, once in a lifetime, to shape our organization and the acquisition system to meet the demands of the 21st century. My role as Undersecretary is to ensure that we have an acquisition system that moves, as Secretary Mattis would say, at the speed of relevance. To do that, we are reshaping ANS as a policy and governance organization that enables, and I really focus and emphasize the word enables, the services and the defense agencies to execute their job successfully. There's a lot of policy and process work required to make such a shift, and critically, to work on cultural change. For example, I want to create a culture of creative compliance. In other words, taking a system with constraints and working creatively and compliantly within that system to achieve the best results for our warfighters and the taxpayer. But enabling the services and agencies also means making sure that they have access to the tools required to do their jobs, which brings us to the JEDI initiative. The cloud is a prime example of the type of technology driving the change that we in the DoD need to embrace. It's driven by the private sector globally at a scale which the DoD cannot compete with. While the cloud can have a game-changing impact for the DoD, it is not exactly bleeding-edge technology anymore. Any startup with a credit card can access the cloud. If we leverage commercially available cloud solutions, we will have the foundational technology in place that we need to deliver better software to our warfighters, faster, with better security, and at a lower cost, and that software will be easier to maintain. If we keep doing business the same old way, our software will be outdated. It will cost far more than it needs to. We won't be able to attract the best software talent, and we'll lose our technological edge. And it won't be because the United States doesn't have access to great technology and talent. It will be because we, and frankly, some of our existing software providers, aren't able or willing to adapt. That's why I'm glad to see the JEDI initiative. It shows the kind of innovation we need in the defense acquisition world. If we think about the technology solution, providing infrastructure as a service and platform as a service solutions on a common defense-wide basis, it's an enabler for innovation. It will lower the barriers to entry to the cloud as well as the cost. It will simplify project initiation, with program managers no longer needing to make independent decisions and undertake contracting actions for basic technology infrastructure. Providing that platform will allow us to embed our policies, particularly for security, into the technology, easing the burden on our people and improving policy compliance. We'll increase interoperability and maintainability of our software, which is something I worry about on a daily basis with our installed base that exists today. Looking at the acquisition strategy, the team is tailoring the internal acquisition methods to make a decision in months, not years. But we're still completing a full and open competition using FAR Part 12 for commercial technology, resulting in a single IDIQ contract. This innovation comes with a price for the JEDI team. They're being held to a higher standard and must bear more scrutiny than other contracts of a similar size. But I believe that investment will generate a rapid return. As someone who's in the middle of a large amount of change, I can tell you that change is uncomfortable. But as I tell our team all the time, we need to get comfortable with being uncomfortable. If we as a department, and you, our industry partners, don't embrace change now, it will be forced upon us at a moment that is not of our choosing. We're going to keep pushing for innovation while working well within the bounds of the law to deliver the best technology to our warfighters at the best value to our taxpayer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Lord. Okay. So far, you've heard the what and the why. So let's talk about the how. Our speakers have gone over the importance of the cloud to the mission and the importance of us doing it quickly and getting it right. As mentioned before, I'm Kate Myers, the JEDI Cloud Computing Program Manager, and I'm going to spend just a few minutes telling you about how we plan to bring this together and ensure the success of the JEDI Cloud. I'll tell you about our new program office and how it will support JEDI, about the new culture we're embracing and the unparalleled support across the department to make that happen. And I'll tell you a little about how we're accelerating adoption and easing access to the cloud. So obviously the first step is this acquisition effort that we're focusing on today. Another critical step is creating the program office that can most effectively manage such a unique effort and integrate it into the fabric of how we in the DoD do business. Nothing about how the department is running this program is traditional, and so neither will be the program office that runs it. The DoD's cloud computing program office will be a mix of users, operators, engineers, acquisition professionals, and process experts. This functionally diverse program office will be designed to optimize the benefits of the JEDI Cloud. As such, it will be constructed to understand both the user's needs and their obstacles. And we will have the resources and flexibility to address those and adapt if necessary. We will actively hunt down any impediments to user success, whether they be operational, logical, policy-based, they may be cultural, or even just a fear of change. We will identify those obstacles and work across the enterprise to tear down barriers while maintaining security, to better understand the concerns, and work to enable mission success for this foundational technology. As you have seen this morning, we have broad support across the department, and we are excited at the high priority and attention this effort is receiving. Standing up the program office under the Chief Management Officer is a clear indication that the department is taking an entirely different approach to this acquisition. This program is directly accountable to implement Secretary Mattis and Deputy Secretary Shanahan's vision for accelerating enterprise cloud adoption and establishing a culture of experimentation, adaptation, and risk-taking to bring critical capabilities to the DoD and the warfighter. Now, earlier I mentioned the policy and process experts, and you just heard Ellen Lord speak to the tailored acquisition process we're following. You see, process, regulations, and some limitations are important. But what really matters and the way we will make this program truly successful is by understanding the meaning and the intent behind them and doing what makes sense to achieve that intent. To that end, we are not just tailoring the acquisition process for JEDI Cloud, but also revisiting and sometimes reimagining the processes around access and user adoption. We'll eliminate unnecessary restrictions and cumbersome processes to make cloud services more accessible and readily available to all across the DoD. With this effort, we will also implement a self-service automated provisioning tool as a key enabler to that rapid access and adoption. We are already working to develop this tool and expect a minimally viable product by JEDI Award. The tool will have built-in controls and oversight for security, billing, and usage, and will be designed to maximize security, ease of use, and develop common standards to take full advantage of cloud services. This tool will be provided by the government, and it will integrate with the provider system through modern APIs. Through this tool, the department will be able to manage a lot of the back-end business processes and implementation of appropriate security policies in an automated fashion rather than manually. Self-service automation to access cloud services in a secure and efficient manner is critical to enabling users to focus their resources on their primary mission. Now, we know that the benefits of commercial cloud are considerable. So once the JEDI cloud becomes a reality, the next step will be to validate that mission capability and optimize the contract to maximize the benefits of the JEDI cloud environment. We will do this through some Vanguard users and their applications, and use those to inform and help build our lessons learned and grow our user playbook for others across the DoD to follow. Here to talk more on that piece is Captain David McAllister from the Strategic Capabilities Office. Captain McAllister.
Thank you, Kate. Good morning, everyone. So I'm going to shake it up a little bit here and actually show you some slides to walk through a few things, the purpose, the goals, how we're going to do phase two, and as a wrap-up slide, kind of give you a little taste of the timeline we're looking at for the phase two projects. So as Kate said, I'm Dave McAllister from the Strategic Capabilities Office, and you may be wondering why the Strategic Capabilities Office is involved in phase two. It's simply, as you've heard from just about every speaker, this is about warfighting advantage. SCO has a long history of working closely with the warfighter to prototype and deliver capabilities in very short timelines, and that's why we are excited about JEDI and glad to be a part of the team. And SCO alone is not doing phase two by itself. We are working very close with the Defense Digital Service, with Sean Heritage and DIUX. Sean's in the crowd here today. So the three offices are really orchestrating a variety of projects. The number hasn't been determined yet. It's somewhere between the 12 and 15 range, but over the course of several years, we're going to try to fully validate the capability within JEDI and then see what we can achieve to deliver warfighting advantage and also those back office efficiencies that you've heard talked about as well. So if you go to the next slide, you should see a slide that says purpose. So this is exactly what we're gonna do. We're gonna prove that by migrating select applications and workload to JEDI, getting those task orders out, we're gonna validate the performance of the infrastructure and platform as a service. And more importantly, from my perspective, we're going to operationalize information. We are going to get after some of the department's most pressing operational challenges and unlock the power of data and analytics. I've been working on some different programs at SCO that have touched upon this, the data and analytics piece, and I think that's where the department's gonna find the most advantage operationally out of JEDI, is getting after those things that we don't know now because we haven't connected the dots. We don't have the tools in the hands of the analysts and the warfighters from the strategic to the tactical edge. And when we give them those tools, I think we're gonna unlock some things we didn't even imagine were gonna happen. But without the tools and the opportunity to use the data, you know, we'll never realize what we don't know. And also what phase two is gonna do for the department is capture those lessons learned, develop a playbook, if you will, so that we can foster and encourage adoption, show people the way to go about this that is efficient and gets them there at speed. Next slide, please. And so our goals, as I've just touched on, are getting after that warfighter advantage and then getting after some of the core business service type things. If we can do things from a personnel front, for example, we have a project or two that touches upon the personnel world. Right now, if you look at any individual service, I think that not one service would say, or the fourth estate, if you will, in OSD would say that we have the systems and the information we need in the hands of the human resources professionals. I think JEDI is gonna give us a tremendous opportunity to explore the power of actually getting onto some applications that will allow us to do things in a much better fashion. And it's from everything from the HR front to the logistics, to the way we do acquisitions, all the way out to the warfighting operations that are going on day in, day out. Next slide, please. So how are we going to do that? We're going to take our pilot cases. We're going to walk them through a logical progress of looking at their data and their applications. And as many of you are familiar with, if you're not getting your data curated and in the right format, you're not going to be able to take advantage of your data in the cloud. So that's an important piece of that and what we are looking at you, industry, to be able to help the department do. We do not have the in-house technical expertise at many of our commands, agencies, and the services to do what we're proposing to do. So we are going to be relying on third-party services to help us get there. So we're looking at taking the data, getting it in the right format, taking the applications that are not currently ready for prime time in the cloud, refactoring those when necessary, rehosting if things are ready to go, and then getting after the important operational problems. And that's where phase two really comes to the front. So if you go to the next slide, you'll see some objectives of what we're looking to validate as we work through this specified number of phase two pilot projects. And you'll see these terms in the draft RFP that you'll get released later today. So we want to validate each of these types of things, these areas of objective areas, if you will, deliberately and in a phased process. So if you go to the next slide, you'll see our timeline for doing so. So right out of the gate, when the contract's awarded and we've got the provisioning tool up and running, we want to make sure that the provisioning tool works as advertised, and we'll have some of our early projects get on that provisioning tool, use it, make sure that it works, give the thumbs up, and then follow-on users will then be able to go into the system. And of course, you can read the slide. This will be available also, I believe, with the documents that are going to be posted later today, from the three-month all the way out to the 2 and 3 year point. Those are the objective areas where we're taking specific projects, making the focal point that proof point that you see annotated by the asterisk. So in a nutshell, that's what phase two is about. It's taking JEDI as we acquire it, and then, as I like to say, putting gas in the tank, kicking the tires, flipping on the ignition, and then shaking the wrinkles out by driving the vehicle. Thank you for your time. I look forward to working with many of you as we realize JEDI and we get to providing warfighting advantage in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. It's almost over, everyone. I know it's been a very long morning. I just want to begin by letting you guys know that we're very excited about the turnout. We've worked on this for several months now, and the fact that you are all here and listening to us and will eventually provide your feedback means a lot. Okay. I'm going to preface my comments by saying that the draft RFP solicitation that we will be posting on FedBizOps later today is indeed a draft. We believe that we have compiled a very good foundation for the JEDI Cloud infrastructure procurement. However, we do need industry feedback on several elements of the draft solicitation. Can you do the next slide, please, Alex? To paraphrase the scope of the acquisition, you've heard over and over commercial cloud infrastructure and platform services for the DoD. So that is what we are procuring. It does not include software as a service. It is only compute and storage. I will say that at this point in time, we are not expecting the classified solution to be accredited and available on day one. There will be a lot more details when you do read through all the documents that would be posted, but I wanted to qualify what you see on the slide by giving you that information. As you can see by the diagram, it should be a diagram for the scope, and you can see that there are shared responsibilities by both the DoD and the cloud service provider, broken out cloud service provider responsibilities, and the section that you see in green are not to be provided by the CSP, but are solely the DoD and the service system owner. Next slide. Uh, To echo what Ms. Lord said earlier, our acquisition strategy is to do a full and open competition. This will result in a single award IDIQ, but as market research indicates, multiple sources are capable of satisfying the DoD's technical requirements. The DoD does require commercial parity, and by that, we want to remain in pace with industry as new commercial solutions are developed in this field. We want for those services to be bought to the DoD under the resulting contract. As you know, anybody that's familiar with federal procurement, we do have a lot of regulations. And I've been in federal procurement for about 10 years, and I can tell you that when I got to the DoD, their supplement is roughly the same size as the overall federal acquisition regulation. So I've heard over and over as contracting officer that a lot of the laws and regulations don't always align or keep pace with industry and technology. And one of the things that we have been talking about is pursuing revisions of internal policies that are unnecessary barriers to success, because we do want to take full advantage of the commercial cloud platform as is. Just to kind of echo what Chris Lynch said earlier about bending the DoD to fit the commercial cloud platform as opposed to creating customized solutions strictly for government, it's very important to bringing the Joint Enterprise Defense Infrastructure Contract to the DoD in order to satisfy its technical needs. Okay. Next slide, please. As I've stated, solicitation will be a full and open competition that will result in a single award, indefinite delivery, indefinite quantity contract. The solicitation will be conducted pursuant to procedures in FAR Part 12, acquisition of commercial items. The anticipated period of performance structure will be a 2-year base period plus a 5-year option ordering period and then a 3-year option ordering period for a potential period of performance of 10 years. It is anticipated that we will request firm fixed pricing via commercial catalogs later on in the slide section. And when you review the draft solicitation material, you will see that the CLIN structure gives you an idea of the types of services that we anticipate will be covered under the IDIQ contract. Now, I want to say again that these things are subject to change. We have put together a framework, and we are definitely reaching out to industry because, as previously stated, you guys are the drivers for the innovation in this field. I will say that my experience in working on the JEDI cloud team has been one that I have never experienced before. By that I mean that this is a true cross-functional effort to put in place an enterprise-wide DoD contract. It has received the support of the highest levels of the DoD. I work on a cross-functional team, and we meet often in a tiny interior meeting room inside of the Pentagon for hours on end, talking about these requirements. This little room has no windows, and we're all crammed inside of this room. And it's done on purpose, because in that room, nobody is important. There are no ranks. There are no egos. It is all about getting the job done. When I was approached to be contracting officer on this particular procurement, DDS came to me and they said, DoD needs a cloud. And so I started to work backward from that point. DoD needs a cloud. That is what I tell myself over and over. And so as the contracting officer, it is my job to help DoD get a cloud. We do anticipate having decentralized ordering underneath the resulting contract, which will mean that since this is enterprise-wide, the OSD level plus all of the services will have their own ordering mechanisms. So hopefully the intent here is to establish commercial catalog pricing that will make it easy for the DoD and its components to access the cloud, the services that they need in order to satisfy their specific requirements. Next slide. What to expect on FedBizOps? Okay, so we have already uploaded the draft documents to FedBizOps, but we have to make it live, and we will do so after this meeting at some point. Barring unforeseen circumstances, it'll be posted later today. What I will say is that the technical requirement leverages the expertise of the DDS. I have oftentimes been a CO on procurements where the technical requirement is very ill-defined. I can tell you that that is not the case with the JEDI procurement. Leveraging the expertise of DDS means that we are able to access advanced technical expertise that the government typically does not have access to. So in order to fully leverage that level of expertise and translating that and synthesizing that information to write the technical requirement for this procurement has been an experience that I have never dealt with in federal government procurement. So I would just say that the DoD is in a unique position to take advantage of the level of technical expertise that's available to us at this point in time. So the FedBizOps documents, the draft solicitation, it won't be the entire solicitation. However, there are some very important aspects of what will be posted that we really, really require your feedback on. What you will see are instructions, draft solicitation selection sections B through M. There's a draft statement of objectives. There's a draft cybersecurity plan, some pricing scenarios, and the JROC memorandum that is not a part of the draft solicitation. However, it's provided as background material for understanding and context of the JROC process and how this became a requirement. There's also instructions on providing feedback. As you know, we're not fielding live questions today, but there is a comment resolution matrix and some instructions where you can make comments on the actual draft solicitation or provide feedback from this industry day or whatever thoughts that you want to relay to us. You would submit that via the instructions using the matrix, and the responses will be posted prior to the solicitation being finalized. So those answers will go out. There is a deadline for doing that, and that also is listed in the draft solicitation information. Next slide. Okay, so key elements of the draft solicitation. The CLIN structure, we are actually soliciting feedback on any and all of these elements. The CLIN structure, right now as it stands, is broken out by classified and unclassified. It has a professional support services CLIN, and it also has transition out and portability. And you will have more of a description later in this slide deck and also as you go through all of the details in the draft RFP. The gate evaluation criteria, acceptable, unacceptable. I would like to call your attention to this specifically when you go through the details of the RFP because these are very, very important. It establishes a minimum criteria that an organization or an offeror must pass in order to move forward through the rest of the solicitation and evaluation process. We feel like the criteria has been well written. We feel like it is definitive. We feel like it is clear. However, if there are any thoughts that you have, we definitely are interested in getting that feedback, because what we hope is that this industry day will help to inform the requirement so that when we finalize the solicitation, it will be something that is reflective of what is actually happening in industry, and it looks fair, impartial, it's unambiguous, all of those types of things, whereas we've been looking at this information for months on end, and now that we have all of these fresh sets of eyes, we are really interested in getting your feedback to help us to shape what the final solicitation for Jedi Cloud will actually look like. Let's see. The technical evaluation criteria will be in there. Non-price demonstrations will be held after the competitive range. That is a section of the draft solicitation that is still under development. So if that section looks a little bit light, it is. We do intend to firm that up and communicate that to you when we publish the final solicitation. So we have a SU affiliated with this. And in response to the SU, we are asking that offers develop a PWS, and there will be additional information on that section as well. That section also is not as well defined, but it will be firmed up, I suspect, after we receive the type of feedback from you guys in order to do that. There also is a detailed cyber security plan that I would like to call your attention to in the draft solicitation packet. In short, I do want for you to read the entire solicitation package from beginning to end, keeping in mind that it is flexible and some of the items are likely to change. We are open to any and all feedback because it may be things that we have not considered. Especially as a contracting officer, I am interested in, we are saying firm fixed price. I am interested in knowing how industry prices these efforts and any type of commercial pricing or structures that you feel like could be pertinent to this particular solicitation. We're interested in definitely receiving that feedback from you. Next slide. Okay, so the draft IDIQ Section B CLINS, we anticipate that the CLINS structure will look something like this. As I said before, unclassified and classified infrastructure as a service and platform as a service commercial offerings will be represented in CLINS 1 and 2. And there's some drop-down, some qualifying information underneath those. The professional support services CLIN, this is not to be confused with a labor hour-based CLIN. That's not what this is. What this really is referencing is commercial catalog IaaS and PaaS offerings to assist with cloud adoption. We are not thinking that this is labor-based, but more of a consultant time-based type feature. If there is any feedback that industry can give us on how that type of professional support services is done as part of your general commercial offerings, we are definitely interested in receiving feedback on that. And then portability and transition out, there will be more information about that in the draft RFP. Next slide, Alex. Okay, so the source selection process. This, what you see here, it basically gives you a broad stroked view of how we intend to evaluate proposals under the RFP. Again, all of these things are subject to change, but as it stands right now, we do have a substantial amount of gate criteria, which I have already previously said that we are interested in you taking special attention to kind of look at this gate criteria and to provide us with feedback. There are 8 sub-factors, and as you go through the information in the draft RFP, you will see information that describes in detail what each of these sub-factors are. And as a gate, you have to pass all of the gate criteria in order to proceed in the to the technical evaluation criteria. If all of the gate pack criteria does not receive, is not evaluated as acceptable for each of the sub-factors, then the proposal as it stands would be ineligible for award because you would not make it to the competitive range. After the proposals are evaluated for gate criteria, you'll move on to be evaluated under the technical evaluation criteria. As you can see from this graphic, that there are 7 different technical evaluation criteria. They will be rated using the adjectival rating process that is described in the draft solicitation, and then combined with the total evaluated price. Competitive range determination will be made, and then after the competitive range has been determined, in accordance with the evaluation process that you will also see listed, then we'll have demonstrations and discussions. After that, it's anticipated that final proposal revisions will probably be initiated, and then the award decision will be made. So there is, this basically gives you a broad stroke of what the source selection or the evaluation process will be. The notional timeline. Now this is just a projected timeline, but right now, later on today, the draft solicitation will be posted. We are asking that comments be submitted by March 21st, and then we anticipate around the time frame of early May, the final solicitation will be posted, and then the contract award. All of these things that I've addressed in the slide deck are fluid and subject to change. We are hoping to stick to this timeline, but of course, it is going to be depending on events as they occur. So the last slide is basically giving you, just rephrasing what I've said previously, all of your comments, feedback, anything that you want to communicate to us relative to this industry day or anything in the content of the draft solicitation should be submitted via the comment resolution matrix. Please do not include any proprietary information in your submittals. They may not be answered. All industry comments and government answers will be posted. Company names will not be included. I cannot stress to you enough, this is not just the line. We do need your feedback on this. We do need for you to point out to us if you see any inconsistencies, any ambiguities in our solicitation material, any departures from commercial offerings, if we're asking for something that you believe is not a typical commercial practice. All of these things you are more experts at than we are, and we won't know unless you give us that type of feedback. Submit all comments to jedi-draft@dds.mil, and that concludes my piece. I want to thank you guys for coming out. That's good.
All right, thank you, Ms. Brooks. Ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of our presentations today. Now, you heard Chris Lynch and Ms. Brooks talk about the technical minds on this effort. We're throwing some of our best technical talent at this, and we want you to do the same. As mentioned, the draft RFP is being released later today. If, after this morning, and after reading through the draft RFP, you have any questions, we want to hear them. Your thoughts and suggestions remain critical to understanding any ambiguity, feasibility, or viability of our requirement. You will be able to submit your feedback and questions by email through the formal comment resolution matrix. You must use this matrix for any and all questions. I thank you again for spending your morning with us. We look forward to engaging with you as we proceed with this acquisition. And for your convenience, the hotel has opened the parking gates, so you do not need your ticket to exit the lot at this time. Thank you and have a nice day.